Let's get into Leave the World Behind a little bit. Now, Jacqueline and I watched this at some point in our hiatus over the last month, so we're going to do our best to recall. And spoiler alerts right now if you haven't seen the movie, because we're going to just talk about everything in the movie with no limitations here. So if you haven't seen the movie, the whole thing's probably going to be a spoiler, so we'll see. Now, I know you haven't seen it, Chance.
No.
But we'll do our best to recall. So the relevance of this movie is that it's an apocalyptic tale, and the movie was at least in part produced by the Obamas, which is weird in and of itself, right?
Very strange.
So here's the IMDb on it.
I like that guy's name, Pavel Frolov. Kevin Bacon's in this?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Kevin Bacon's in it.
Julia Roberts. It was actually a decent movie.
Yeah, it was a decent movie with like no ending, if you ask me.
Yeah, the ending was not okay. It leaves you with a lot of unanswered questions.
Oh, well, then there's nothing to spoil.
But overall, I mean, it definitely was, I mean, it had our attention.
Yeah, so here's the Wikipedia on it. Now, apparently this was based off a book, from what I understand. And it was something Obama had read and was interested in. At least that's what they say, and got involved with the production of it somehow. Which, I mean, like, I don't know as much about this as I'd like to, but I know, like, a producer might have no involvement in it other than, like, financial backing, right? Or they can have a lot of involvement in the actual production.
I didn't realize that Denzel Washington was supposed to be in it. Apparently he was, like, replaced.
So it says, former U.S. President Barack and First Lady Michelle Obama executive produced the film through their Higher Ground production banner. Obama included the novel on his 2021 summer reading list. Interesting. Higher Ground production. So this seems kind of unprecedented anyway for an ex-president to get into movie production, right? I don't think that's ever...
No, I
can't. Mean, like, of course
Reagan
was an actor, and, you know, Trump's been on TV, so I guess it's not that crazy. But what makes this particularly weird is the subject matter of the movie and some of the lines that are in it. This is apparently the book it's based on.
I read it to see if it has an ending.
Yeah, not chilling the book or anything, but I guess you could watch it and not know that it was based on a book. You guys want to watch the trailer real quick? Let's do that.
There's something wrong with the TV. It's all messed up.
I wonder what that means.
Well, what could it mean? It could be over in a couple of hours.
You know something. I'm sure this will turn out to be a big nothing.
We'll look back on this one day and laugh, I guarantee you.
I think that ship is
I'm not familiar with the director's body of work.
What does that mean?
We shouldn't speculate. Haven't you been picking up on what's going on out there?
I don't want to panic over nothing.
The gear, I find interesting.
That's a really weird part of it.
Quite a bit in the movie in different
ways. We're in this
well,
together.
Things get back to normal. There's
no going back
right
to normal.
Now.
Yes.
In the car! Whoever's pulling the strings wants us to finish it.
We're going to be okay, right?
Yeah.
What's weird about this is, like, we've already had internet issues, you know, like, you with things going out.
Potential attacks on infrastructure.
So when things like this in movies show up and they're like, you know, the internet's going out and all these strange things, it almost feels like they're just warning us of what's to come.
Predictive programming.
The movie is set in, like, pre-apocalypse, I would say. Like, it's not a post-apocalyptic movie, but
like on the advent of it.
Yeah, so how do I do a good summation of this? And Jacqueline, you paid better attention to the beginning of it, so correct me if I'm wrong here.
Okay.
There's a family that essentially gets like an Airbnb, right?
Yes.
And leaves kind of on a whim to go out into the country from the city. At the same time this happens, a bunch of weird events start happening. A ship crashes on the shore.
Planes start dropping out of the sky.
There seems to be some power issues, right?
Yeah.
Infrastructure issues.
Internet went down.
Yeah, communications go down. And so they're trapped at this house. And then apparently the owners of the house come back. Seeking refuge from what's happening out there in the world.
The city had, like, you know, been under attack.
Right. Or something bad's happening. Things are going down. The system's breaking down on multiple levels, particularly infrastructure.
So now the family and the people that actually own the house are having to stay together, but given they don't know each other, so they're like questioning whether or not they should even trust each other. And people are like, you know, killing each other. Like, not yet, but like they're preparing for it. They don't want to trust anybody around them.
Yeah, and there's some strife between, you know, the families, because it's this, I don't know the actor's name. Been in a lot of stuff. Sure I can pull it up, but it's this black guy and his daughter shows up to come back to their house while it was being rented out, and they end up staying with this white couple and their two kids. And it's a son and a daughter. So, I mean, that's kind of the setup to the whole thing.
Well, and the family tries to leave to go back to the city, but like 500 bajillion Teslas had all driven themselves down the highway and wrecked into each other. So there was no way to get back to the city.
Yeah, a bunch of self-driving cars like blocked the roadways.
So, and they were all crashed and everything, so there's no way to get through. So they turn around and have to go back to the Airbnb place and basically has to stay with these owners, even though that they had kind of treated them pretty crappy.
Yeah, yeah. And there was a controversial line in it about, you know, trust. It was something like trust shouldn't be doled out. So this is from the Black Daughter, that trust shouldn't be doled out generously, or some, I'm paraphrasing, in times like these, especially to white folks, which was
interesting.
One of the controversial lines in it. You know, I don't know, that kind of rolled off my back on whatever. Yeah. And I kind of, you know, in terms of reviewing the movie, I kind of enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Up until the end.
Same. That scene with the deer where they basically stand around the shed or wherever they were, and the deer surround them, and they are like ready to eat these people, and they fight them, you know, they get them off. But the deer were a big part of the movie, and I
when other animals behaving strangely.
Yes.
So they start hearing, and I'm probably not getting this right chronologically, but they start hearing what sounds like these like sonic weapons, these like
loud ringing,
yeah, these pulses that are going out that are audible. And when they go out, it just knocks everybody down.
Well, and the son ends up getting sick because of the noise. Something happens to him.
Yeah, he gets he's like outside during this noise, and
that's technology that exists. There's patents for it.
Yeah, we talk about Havana syndrome, right? In Cuba, the rumor was anyway that this has happened. Okay, so it's not like there's not unprecedented. Like you said, there are actual patents, like military patents for non-lethal technologies that put out ultrasonic bursts and stuff like that at particular frequencies. So, you know, they start hearing these loud bursts, and there's also like a plane that they hear of, a plane that dropped leaflets that were in, what language was it?
Oh man, there was
like Chinese or
something like that.
Well, like she was saying, the son gets caught out in one of these ultrasonic bursts or something, and is kind of messed up by it. And by the next day, his like teeth are falling out.
All his teeth fell out. Like something out of a bad dream that I've had.
So the families kind of band together, and the two fathers, they go to Kevin Bacon, who plays kind of prepper redneck type
survivalist.
Yeah, to seek out medicine, and they offer, they want to buy medicine from him, antibiotics or something. And he doesn't want to sell them, and there's kind of a standoff, and ultimately it ends in, look, we're going to give you a ton of cash for the medicine, and he actually does. But in the meantime, he says that he had heard word of flyers being dropped that were like in Arabic or something like that. So they're hearing about flyers from China or seeing them. And then these flyers are being dropped kind of like Hiroshima style. You know, before they drop the nuclear bombs, they drop flyers on the population to warn them that it was going to happen. But they're in different languages, so it's hard to tell where this potential cyber attack could be coming from. And the animals are behaving strangely. At some point, a flock of flamingos, I think it was, lands in their pool.
Yeah. Oh,
which that'd be cool. Had no business in the Northeast. There is a group of deer that looks like it's going to maul them, which is extra weird, which, you know, you mentioned chronic wasting disease, and that is a prion disease, and it's terrifying. It folds proteins.
It makes me not want to eat deer anymore.
It can't be destroyed. It's similar to mad cow to some degree, mm-hmm. but probably worse, because you can't destroy it. It gets into the environment.
You can't destroy mad cow either. They have to burn the bodies, completely incinerate them to dust.
Well, the daughter throughout the movie, and big spoiler here if you care about this ending, can't get her mind off of watching the last episode of Friends, because before everything goes down, she's on the last episode of Friends, serial watching it or something. And she finds the neighbor's bunker and finds the last episode of Friends and plays it, and the movie ends. So I'm sure I skipped some of that.
Yeah.
Not a professional movie reviewer, but one of the key things in it that I think we should discuss is the owner of the house. When he comes back, apparently he was somewhat of a power broker with corporate or Washington types, and he doesn't say a ton about it, but he says something about a guy that he knew who was taking his money and bugging out.
Getting gone.
Yeah, he'd left the country, and that made him suspicious or something. And he says there's some line in it which, you know, Rec had pointed out, and I had read that Obama wrote script notes for this movie. Apparently Barack Obama wrote script notes, I think. And I wonder if this line, it calls into question whether this could have come from Obama or been influenced by him. But to paraphrase, he says something like, you know, when the shit hits the fan, the truth is nobody's in control. And the most powerful people, the best they can ask for is a heads up for what's about to happen.
Uh-huh.
Well, nobody's steering the ship. Try to call the dad of the, he's staying in the Airbnb, and tries to warn him, something's about to happen, but then the phone goes dead.
Yeah, it's
interesting movie for sure.
Yeah, well, and any other day you would see this movie, and if you didn't know it was produced by the Obamas, it would probably just be like, okay, you know, we talk a lot about predictive programming. Is that what this is? Kevin Bacon at one point says, when they're hypothesizing about who they're under attack by, because nobody knows, that he believes that, you know, America's made a lot of enemies in the past. Maybe some of them have finally just teamed up against us. Something like that.
We've got bricks.
Right.
I mean, if that isn't a team of...
Go ahead and elaborate on bricks while I catch a breath here.
Yeah, definitely. I'm going to have to look up who all exactly is in it. But it is a coalition of several different countries. It is an intergovernmental organization composing Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, Egypt, Ethiopia, Iran, Saudi Arabia, and the United Arab Emirates. So there are quite a lot of countries in there that I would say we're not on the friendliest terms with.
Well, and they're competing they're creating a currency to compete against the US dollar, mm-hmm. is the point of BRICS. Like, you know, just put it simply, the US dollar, frequently referred to as the petrodollar, is propped up by the fact that if you want to buy oil, you usually have to convert your money to US dollars. So we're kind of a global fiat currency, is where that term comes in. It's like a default currency to trade for oil. And other, these countries, BRICS, are banding together to create other currencies that might potentially compete against the US dollar as a fiat currency.
Which, in its thought, isn't a horrible idea. The US dollar is like one of the most manipulated currencies that has ever existed.
Yeah, I mean, it's what I always, the amount of currency that was printed throughout COVID, it was something like 90% of dollars in circulation, not necessarily paper money, but in accounts and stuff, was actually created during COVID, which is a really good way to rob the middle and lower class of any wealth that they happen to have left by devaluing the currency.
Uh-huh.
And taking a bigger chunk of the pie. No, I mean, like, it goes really deep into some topics, but the other thing that they talk about is like a coup or controlling a population and how there would be different steps in it. And one of those first steps would be confusion. Confuse and isolate the population before you can come in and take it over.
Yeah.
You know, destroying infrastructure, things like that. And basically there's this multi-point plan hypothesized to, you know, enact a takeover of a country like this. And the steps that were being followed in the movie were essentially that. I think the animal stuff, as particularly the deer, were some of the weirdest stuff. I don't know if that was a symbol or something. You know,
some kind of thematic, like...
Yeah, some sort of symbology. that if it was, it kind of went over my head. But it was weird, especially, again, in the context that it was produced part by the Obamas.
On its face is so... Especially with what kind of topic this is covering.
Right, I feel like it's a warning. Y'all ever seen the show Revolution? It was a few years, for a decade ago. It's very similar. The power goes out, militias start, they have to fight. I feel like we're just getting warned of what's to come.
Well, there's a lot of apocalyptic themes in movies and stuff, and there have been for a long time. So it's like I said, it's not like it stands out in that regard, but it's almost like they were letting some truths slip through in this.
It always seems to be the internet. The internet goes out, or
it is the single main method of communication.
Well, and I feel like we've already had these weird glitches, like a lot in the last year. I just feel like it's really weird. And then like the high school here the other day went completely out.
That's weird. Were there? Well, there's.
I think we went over this before when we talked to that guy. We all went to the T-Mobile store, the Metro store, to get phones one day because they were running a deal. So the three of us walked in, you know, 30 minutes before closing to be these people's worst enemy. But at least we were prepared. We were like, we know what we want. They got us in and out. But we were talking to the guy there, and you know, he was going off on conspiracy stuff about, yeah, the number of these towers are down, and if you know. If you ask me, well, if the official narrative is they're under maintenance or something, but if you ask me, it's something else. And we got him to open up about how he thought it was cyber attacks. And the question is, you know, what cyber attacks occur and at what level are they going to tell us about it? Are the power brokers even going to admit to them?
Someone needs to make a FOIA request.
I don't know how much you're going to get that's not redacted, though.
It's all going to be redacted. I dig through FOIA fairly often, and everything is just black bars and black bars and two words and a black bar and three words and a black bar.
You guys remember when the Southeast, there was that whole cyber attack on the that affected like oil and gas, and nobody could get gas? This was a few summers ago. My parents were visiting.
I vaguely remember something about that.
Yeah. And like they they took a hit, and I don't know if the company paid the ransom. You know, I'm talking off the cuff, so I don't remember all the details, but I remember it was some sort of cyber attack, and there was lines for gasoline a mile long. all over the Southeast not long ago.
Yeah.
So it's.
I do remember that happening.
This stuff does happen. There's been cases where 401ks, like people's 401k, not just people, but like unions' 401ks have been taken over, and they've ended up forced to pay ransoms to get access back to everybody's money, and it's just crazy stuff.
Yeah, that is spooky to say the least.
Yeah. I'm under the impression that, yeah, I mean, cyber attacks happen,
mm-hmm.
and they're probably happening a lot more than we know.
Yeah. We only hear about the huge ones, like the big, big boys that you can't ignore, like they won't be able to push under a rug somewhere.
Well, nobody can do anything without pen and paper. You can't order at McDonald's without the internet anymore.
Mm-mm.
It's just
they don't even walk up to the counter anymore. They'll just stare at you until you do the kiosk.
Uh-huh.
It's true.
I hate that. It drives me insane.
If the internet went down, like even regionally, it would just shut down everything.
Oh yeah.
You talk about EMPs, sonic weapons.
Well, they shut down Fry's the other day because the computers were down.
Yeah, the grocery store. Yep.
Oh. I mean, I feel like it's already kind of happening sometimes. A couple days later, the high school goes out. Like,
I'll tell you, when I was working at the pawn shop for a little while, we had our computer systems go down. We still had to run. We had an entire box in the back that was dedicated to these just god-awfully long paper forms that we had to fill out. And it was the most distressing thing. Every time our computers went out, I was like, I'm calling my manager, and I'm like, I'm leaving. This is, nope, I'm not doing it. Not doing it.
I don't think this nation could survive
without it. We become too accustomed to it, and there's generations now that have existed without even knowing what it's like to do things like business on pen and paper.
They wouldn't know what to do.
But there's a level of apathy that occurs with a lot of low-wage jobs, you know? And not that they're not essential workers or anything, but it's like the old Soviet Union phrase, it's something like, you know, we pretend to work and they pretend to pay us.
Uh-huh.
So you get these hires that probably aren't the most qualified for the job to begin with, and then there's low wages. She shut the easy way to do anything off, and it's not like there is a system to do anything. It would be chaos.
Mm-hmm. Bring us, let us know what your thoughts on both experimental laser aliens and the international Swiss banking cartel are.
Yeah.
I also have some chats in Rumble as well.
Yeah, Rex's been talking a lot. I know he's interested in the Leave the World Behind discussion. Feel free to call back in if you want. Not, no worries. And if you are watching us, please be sure to like and subscribe. We really appreciate it.
Right. All right. Oh, God, my arm.
It would, but I have a sleeping puppy. He did.
Phone number is 857-32-D-DIAL. That's 857-323-3425.
Give us a ring.
Give us a ring. Be sure to like and subscribe. Check us out on darkdial.com. We've still got that forum set up. But we do have all of our socials available at darkdial.com if you want to follow us on any particular place. We'll meet you where you're at. And if you're on Rumble watching, please do give us a follow. Oh, hey, forget the jams. We got a
call from
Rec.
To accept, press 1.
Rec
to
is
send
back.
A voicemail, press 2.
You're on.
Hello, hello, Rec. How you doing?
Hi, I guess I'm back.
Yay! Indeed you are.
Glad to have you back.
Well, I was hoping, I waited to see if anybody else would call before. I don't want to take up the time. But
no, I'm glad you called because I knew you had something to say about this one.
Well, I think my biggest thing about the Leave the World Behind, and I was going to do a video about it, and then life got a hold of me. I didn't need a chance to do it, but when I saw Leave the World Behind, I knew it's one of those films, again, and we've talked about this before, where there are some films where it's like, it's just entertainment, whatever. This one's not one of them, right? Mm-hmm. I think that's clear. And I did mention a couple of things in chat, but like, just to kind of put it in there as a, just to kind of illustrate how, like, how smart this movie is. Like, it was done well, and I don't particularly disagree with the people that made it, you know, like the direction they lean and stuff. I'm skeptical of them, but it was done well, and so I can't deny that. It's very, very smart. I mean, so smart that, like, even, like, the stag, I mentioned before, the stag symbolism come up, because that's one of the parts that people are criticizing the film about, because the whole deer thing. The deer thing is weird to me. Everybody says the deer thing's weird. Well, when you go back to the stag symbolism, and I'm trying to remember, I thought I had it pulled up. Yeah, so I double-checked to make sure. But the stags that are in this, because there's different meanings behind different kinds of stags. Because white stags, red stags, and black stags have different, you know, meanings in the occult or in the in ancient religions and that. In this particular case, it's a black stag. It's a dark stag, which symbolizes death and transformation. The dark hue represents mystery and the unknown, and emphasizes the cycle of life and death. So that is, to me, an intentional placement of that symbolism in this movie, because that undertone is in the entire movie.
Yeah, it's all over it, and the stags are all over it. The deer are, and I know, I forget, we've talked about that before when we were talking about symbolism in some other video.
I pet goat too.
Okay, yeah. I don't remember if it was the amazing, we did the amazing digital circus too.
Yeah, that one as well. That didn't have any stag stuff in, but it kind of crossed over in the same time there. Yeah. Stags, I'm
Utopia
looking,
and that kind of stuff too.
No doubt. I'm looking into some stuff. It looks like
it's like pagan symbolism, right?
Yeah, and it appears in a lot of like royal crests, like heraldic crests and things like that, like coat of arms. You see a lot of stag symbolism in those as well.
Yeah. Yeah, I had brought it up in I think Knowing used it. The Ritual film used it. So in the more darker sense, there is an occult thing. There's also like, when it's like the white stag, there's a complete opposite, you know, meaning behind it. You know, their purity and mystery, innocence and untouched snow. So there's an untarnished spirit. So like when you use a white stag for symbolism, it's a different thing.
Yeah.
So, but in this film, it's the black stag. It's a darker, like, you know, a dark hue, the gray stag. And then another thing, just to kind of show how deep a thought they put into this film, in the map, have you seen the QR code in the map?
No.
Okay, so early in the film, and I can't remember where it's at exactly. I'd have to pull it up, but there's when they get the short blip on the TV that shows that there's a cyber attack, and they show a map of the United States. Well, in that map is actually a QR code that if you can manage to pull off a high enough resolution, you can scan that QR code for real, and it takes you to a real website about the Lake Shawnee Abandoned Amusement Park. Which is a Native American burial ground. Had a lot of violent deaths, freak accidents.
I was going to say, didn't they have the freak accidents on the carousel? And it's like, I've seen something on the internet about this. We watched a video.
Yeah. So, I mean, you don't put that in your movie. Like, to put that in there in a blip in the screen, you know.
Weird.
That's intentional. So, and then the last, and I think I mentioned this in chat, but the other thing that kind of got me, like I said, I don't necessarily know what all it means, other than that, you know, I'm just trying to paint a picture of like the intention of all this stuff. The manufacturer of the bunker in the neighbor's house, the name of the manufacturer is Commodus. And Commodus was a Roman emperor who ruled from 177 to 192. And he was assassinated. And one of the things he was known for was devaluing the Roman currency. because he reduced the weight of the denarius from 105 per Roman pound to 96 per Roman pound. So it's, you see some of that. I mean, that's something that we're talking about. You even brought it up a little bit ago, Gavin, talking about when it comes to bricks and all that, and all that with the other countries and their coalition of, you know, competing with the American dollar.
Yeah.
So do I know what all this bill means? No, but with the, you take, you know, the knowledge that the Obamas, you know, consulted on the script and had their notes. We don't know what those notes exactly were. And I've never read the original book to compare it. So I had to see a breakdown of that to get a picture of what maybe changed from the book to see how much influence perhaps the Obamas actually had. But, you know, you start looking at the deep things I just, you know, pointed out, this movie is not just entertaining. It definitely tells me that this movie is saying, hey, pay attention.
That's what I got out of it.
Oh, that is interesting.
Do you think it's a warning? And if it is, what's the motivation to even give that warning?
Honestly, well, the question mark comes up. I mean,
the question mark. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
I was just saying, and like, I don't think the woke people would even see that. I think there's only going to be a few of us that see it as like, hey, get ready.
Well, it sounds like you have to be fairly well versed in a little bit of history to catch some of the stuff going on in this too.
Yeah, it's deep. I mean, some of the stuff they did, the attention to detail is more of an art choice. If you pay attention, the painting in the living room changes three times. It's one way in the first act, it's one way in the second act, and it's one way in the third act. And same with the mural behind the bed in the bedroom. It goes from small calm waves in the first act to the second act. It has higher waves, and by the third act, the mural in the bedroom is violent tidal waves. So that's a visual, that's more of a visual cue, I think, from an art standpoint to say, to kind of go along with like how the story's ramping up.
Right.
That's
wild. You're blowing my mind.
Yeah, I feel like I need to rewatch and look for like the small detailed stuff now.
Yeah. The flamingos had a meaning too, and I forgot what it was. I had to look it up again, but there was a thing about the flamingos about being lost or something to that effect. The Tesla thing is interesting. I don't know. I mean, like, I kind of half wonder because, you know, the government has kind of turned, this administration anyway, has kind of turned their political ire against the Tesla company, right? They're kind of backing, you know, GM and other companies as far as the electrical vehicle company, which is it more of a jab? You know, that they use the Tesla cars in the movie? I don't know. But there certainly seems to be something to that as well. But there's, I mean, but that's kind of interesting because, like, just even if it wasn't Tesla, that has been a fear. I mean, that kind of goes along with the idea of AI taking over and, you know, all those things in the conspiracy field that we've worried about. So, yeah, I mean, you could go on about this movie, and I can get kind of disjointed after a while, too, without doing an organized, you know, breakdown of it.
Right, yeah. Yeah, no, I felt that way when I was trying to summarize the thing. But,
yeah,
I mean, how do you feel about that whole bulletin point, like the steps of usurping a civilization?
Well, I mean, okay, so to me, I always go back to 1977 when Yuri Bezmenov defected from the USSR, right? And he spoke to this thing exactly. He if you watch this movie, and then you go back and you listen to what, you know, he talked about in his interviews, it's almost like you can see a correlation, like it's finally, it feels like it's finally happening in a way.
I honestly don't know anything about that. Chance, you fingered.
I know the name.
I
know of the incident. I don't know anything about what he said, but I've heard of him defecting before.
Yeah. So look him up, Yuri Bezmenov. There's actual videotape interviews, and he lays it all out about how you would use essentially non-violent psychological games to subvert a whole society. And it really comes down to playing the long game, a generational long game. But, you know, he said that it only takes one generation to derail, completely derail a society.
That makes sense. You know, Jacqueline and I have talked privately a lot about how, you know, kids who were raised in lockdown and during COVID, how their experience of freedom and the way things should be is very different than the experience that I had growing up. So what is an acceptable right. level of freedom to me may no longer be, you know, what they perceive as acceptable.
Right. You're conditioned into a lesser amount of freedom as the norm, and it doesn't even faze you as something that's actually a violation.
You wouldn't know the difference because you never experienced anything but it.
Right. You know, as time's gone on with this stuff, I think less and less in terms of a vast, organized cabal, as it were. I start leaning away from that more, and it, because it's no longer necessary, I don't think. I think the seeds were planted enough long ago that it's starting to happen organically. And I think even in this film, like the line that you pointed out, Chance, was when he was talking about, I forget his name too at the moment, but when Julia Roberts and the guy was having that conversation in the kitchen.
Oh, when, yeah, he's about. Talking about how the best, I think what you mean is he had said something like the best, any powerful person who's in control, they're not really in control. The best they can ask for is like right. a heads up when something happens.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. That's what I was trying to get to.
I kind of wonder
that's not real.
Go ahead.
I think it might be. I've heard someone describe the power struggle between the various, I guess I'll call them the various cabals, as kind of a game of King of Hill on a pile of mud, where the best you can do is hope to just slide someone else down the pile and get on top for a minute before you slide down.
Seemed apt.
Yeah, that's, yeah. I could see that. That's a similar, I hadn't quite had it put in quite that colorful way before, but I had a friend of me say something similar about, you know, like, more like along the lines of, you know, so many people have a seat at the table and not all of them get along, you know, and you see things like, you know, like the Musks and the Trumps of the world, like they appear to be like, you know, they have the money to be at the table, but they don't all get along about it. You know what I mean? The thing that's interesting, and this could derail real fast, but the reason it's interesting that year keeps coming up, the 2030s keep coming up, because the original agenda for the whole, before the whole, you know, the COVID thing, and in was the agenda 21, and then it got it changed. They changed it to agenda 2030. You can actually look it up. It actually is called agenda 2030. Right?
Yeah.
Well, then you look up that the asteroid Apophis is due to pass by Earth in very close proximity in 2029. And Apophis is an interesting name for an asteroid that's gonna, you know, hopefully miss Earth, because Apophis represents death. It's crazy.
Is this the asteroid that's central to like Graham Hancock's theory on ancient civilizations and their decimation?
Yeah, that definitely ties in there. And that's a whole other thing. That's why I'm saying all these subjects seem to kind of start to cross over after a while, because like we're gaining this knowledge, like you're stating with Graham Hancock saying these things, but I don't know, you know, like the whole stuff in Turkey being uncovered. All these things are happening all at once. All this knowledge is being gained of this, like, you know, ancient civilizations potentially being a real thing and history being a lie, all those things, right? And when it comes to the slow rollout and disclosure, does it have something to do with that? And I think you may be onto something about the idea that it's getting to a point where they can't keep a lid on it. So they have to get people used to hearing about it before it's actually completely told as being the truth. I don't know.
So,
but you could argue that that's a conditioning of society, and you can also argue that, like, why it would why I'm making a correlation to, like, the previous segment of the film is that film is, you know, films like it is a conditioning of society as well, if that makes sense.
So I looked up Apophis real quick, and 5 yeah. days ago on Wikipedia there was something added to the Apophis. This is wacky. A small possibility nevertheless remained that during its 2029 close encounter with Earth, Apophis would pass through a gravitational keyhole of no more than about 800 kilometers in diameter, which would have set up a future impact exactly 7 years later on April 13th, 2036.
Wait, the first date you said was 2029?
Mm-hmm. It's going to pass by Earth on 2029 and slingshot back around and hit in 2036.
Well, that's terrifying.
And what was the date that I first said?
2029. Oh yeah, no, you're exactly. That's why I'm bringing it up.
You
said 2036. I read that and it just whoop, and that was added 5 days ago to Wikipedia.
Yep. So yeah, it makes you wonder.
Oh, that's something. Are we about to get wiped out by an asteroid, and that's why Bezos is launching himself into space?
Well, that's definitely something I think they fear when you get into, like, neo-humanism.
That's scary.
They just want to figure out...
Even if that doesn't happen, it certainly seems like we're approaching some sort of technological singularity in that, you know, with AI...
Quantum computing...
Yeah, and the exponential growth of processing power, all of these technologies emerging, that we are speeding up our progress at a rate where, you know, years from now, we will be making as much progress as we made in the previous 10 years in like a day.
Right.
And when that happens, things are going to get wacky. They're going to get out of control. And I'm sure that unnerves the people who do have some control of the reins of global agendas.
Yeah. I mean, in the level of, like, it's an advancement, the knowledge, like the knowledge we're gaining, the level of advancement we're hitting right now again, does seem to be staggering. And you kind of wonder, I mean, if, again, the whole 2036, 2029, you know, apocalyptic, you know, or I shouldn't say apocalyptic because people misuse that word, but the cataclysmic kind of events is, you know, again, you can pretty quickly discredit yourself with, you know, trying to prophesy those dates. But, I mean, we do know for a fact that Apophis is a real thing. That's not like a conspiracy theory thing. That's a real, you know, asteroid, and they are keeping their eye on it, and it has come up in the scientific circles.
Not only is there
some legitimacy there.
Not only is it a real thing, it is also the name of an ancient Egyptian deity who embodied darkness and disorder. And that goes into some weird stuff about Egyptians being like a civilization that kind of knew more than they should or was able to accomplish more than they should.
Well, we know that these kind of cataclysmic impacts happen. It's not science fiction. They're in history. We push them out of our minds because of some level of hubris that we're here now and we'll always be here, but that certainly doesn't seem to be the case. I always like to throw around this theory that, you know, if there was some sort of Gaian hive mind of all life, that after, you know, life on Earth getting destroyed by so many impacts and having to reset over and over, would it not make sense that at some point this Gaian mind would project a species above others that might actually be able to defend against something like a meteor impact? Which
that's exactly where my brain was going to.
Yeah. That could be the whole purpose of humans. I don't know.
Right. You kind of wonder if, you know, if the apophis thing, you know, the predictions do come true as far as like its potential for causing an impact, or at least, at the, you know, very least causing some kind of major disruption, even if it didn't directly impact this. Are we hitting a point now where we are ramping up our knowledge and we're gaining it so quickly that, like you said, we are going to, by the time we get there, we're going to have the ability in some way preserve some aspect of humanity to survive? It won't necessarily be all of us, but maybe some aspect of us. I don't know. Does that mean getting off planet? Does that mean going to Mars? Does that mean, you know, what does it mean?
Maybe that's what the warning is. Like, hey, you know, get high and dry right now because the ocean's about to come, you know, inland.
Right? Yeah, but then you got, you have Zuckerberg, you know, building a $250 million bunker over in Hawaii. So, I mean, you're like, well, okay.
Yeah, it makes you wonder.
Yeah. So, I was like, Hawaii going to be safe? How would you know that? Like, I wouldn't predict going to Hawaii to be safe in a big cataclysm. I don't know, because it's a very small island compared to the ocean.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to be in Hawaii.
No, me neither.
Middle of the Pacific, surrounded by ocean, limited resources, no paths in and out.
Volcanoes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did we learn nothing from Pompeii? Can't.
There's certainly, this movie comes off as a warning, whether it is or not. It comes off as one, you know, it makes you want to move up into the mountains and buy a radio and build a Faraday cage and all that.
I know. Yeah. Yeah. It's very interesting. Yeah.
We need to start on our bunkers.
So it's, like I said, you know, when you go through all those things and you look at how much thought goes into that, that's when I knew my red flags went up on a movie like that. You know, most movies, it's funny because last time I talked to you guys about it, or one of the first times I called in and talked about things, it was about movies that do that and how I, you know, hadn't seen a lot recently doing that. And then this movie comes along. Like, okay, I guess it's due to have one of these movies made that does that again.
It was wild. And, you know, it sounds like you enjoyed the movie and thought it was really competently made, and I felt the same way.
Yeah, I agree.
How did you feel about the ending, though? Did it feel like it kind of, just as a review of the movie itself, did it feel like it kind of should have thumbed up better? It felt like there was no closure to me.
Well, you know, I need to go back and revisit that, because I always kind of meant to. I sort of feel the same way, but I reserved making that as a final judgment of it, because knowing how much thought is buried in this movie, I wonder about this, because one of the things I thought about doing is actually going back and watching that particular episode of Friends. I never watched Friends. And so I wonder, I kind of half wonder if there isn't something significant about that episode of Friends that
they do bring it up a lot.
They do. It ties it together. Now it's interesting. One aspect you could take from it, because you look at the little girl's perspective. She is obviously separated from everybody else. Is concerned about everything else going on. And being in a state of confusion, not knowing what's happening, not knowing which way, not knowing how to handle things. Yet she has this hyper-focused goal to accomplish this one thing. And it's interesting. Does it mean in her case, because she's this childlike innocence, that does her character? I'm only asking this question because I wonder. Does her character represent symbolically what your average person whom is asleep to all this stuff going on? Like, your normie, as we like to call them, who doesn't think this deeply about movies and society and politics. And we're really focused on our little tiny world, and we only have that part of our brain engaged, right? Does she kind of represent that? You know, because she has this one goal, and it's just this burying herself inside this make-believe world that she can unplug from reality. And does that kind of sort of represent a normie?
It's interesting because, like, we talked about how it only takes one generation to acclimatize a population to a particular way of living, whether that be with less freedom or more freedom or whatever. Maybe that's kind of what she is representing.
Yeah, it's a question mark for me. Like I said, I won't be able to answer that until I actually maybe go back and see if there wasn't something else for that Friends episode. But, and it could be overthinking it too, but I sort of doubt it considering, like I said, the detail they put into, like I said, even the bunker was commodus.
But she definitely seems to be phased less than any of them.
I feel like this whole generation is phased less.
Yeah, like she's oblivious to the dangers.
They lived the last 4 years in mask. They didn't see people's emotions. They only saw eyes. Like, they just don't have the same view of things as we do. They literally live on the internet. They wouldn't know how to... I mean, they're kind of self-centered. You know what I mean? Like, they're so focused on themselves, right, that they don't understand what's going on around them.
Well, and if there was some sort of cataclysmic event, there would, you know, probably be humans that survive it one way or another, whether that's tribes out in the woods or, you know, and they might revert to a more primitive style of living, and just that would be life. They wouldn't know any other way. They wouldn't long for the old ways.
Look what they're also pushing right now. Like, you know, the Oculus with the virtual, you know, thing where you're living in the
augmented reality.
Yeah, you're living in your world, but you're living in a fake world. I mean, that kind of, to me, is like a version of that little girl. Like, she's detached from the real world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it could be that simple, you know? And is that, because I talk about it all the time, like about how normies are, you know, not paying attention, and it's frustrating. And likewise, that ending's frustrating for people about, you know, why is this Friends thing so important? You know, why does that matter? And so on its surface, it appears to be a bad ending. But, you know, like I said, maybe it completely sums up, you know, it's its own warning, saying you don't pay attention, the world's falling apart around you, and you don't even pay attention to it.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to get people to pay attention when they're just trying to put food on the table. When you're just in survival mode, it's kind of hard for you to sit back and have a look at the big picture.
Right.
Well, I think that's a good spot for us to end it. Unless you got anything else for us.
No, I don't. I'm again, sorry, I go so long.
No, don't apologize at all.
I appreciate it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks a lot, guys. Really do appreciate it.
Hey,
thanks for hanging out with us.
Yeah, I really appreciate you calling about this one. That's very interesting because you brought up some stuff I didn't catch some of those little details, which
I'm going
are mind-blowing. And the stuff about the little girl in the ending, that's really interesting.
Yeah, I think we're going to have a follow-up on this one.
Yeah, I was going to say, I feel like I need to rewatch this movie and watch that the last episode of Friends and see if I can, like, put it together.
Hi, this is Gavin with Dark Dial. Welcome into the CRT. If you like this video, please be sure to like and subscribe. It really helps us out as a channel, and it helps you find us that much easier. If you can leave a comment down below, we'd love to know what you thought about the video. We're going to be live typically on Thursdays, 6 o'clock Pacific, 4 o'clock Central, and be sure to check out darkdial.com. We've got a cool forum you can sign up for, as well as links to all of our social accounts on there. Thanks for watching.